Hey, what's going on, gamers? Once again, it's been a while since I've made a video about the development progress of my NES game. Unfortunately, I haven't added any new gameplay features. But as the title suggests, I've decided to make an intro. So whenever I don't know what else to add to my game, I always try to relax, sit down and play the game on the console. I usually get some good ideas this way. This time, it seemed to me that there is no initial motivation to play the game. So your character is there, but what's the goal? Why should I go somewhere and do things? So I figured, why not to add an intro cutscene and explain what's going on? I don't know about you, but to me, the cutscenes on the NES were always something magical. Something that gets you pumped up about the game you're about to play. Like when you see that Batman cutscene before the first level. Or the one in the TMNT game. So cool. I definitely needed something like that in my game as well. At first, I sketched out a rough storyboard. I tried to make the shots as simple as possible, since I'm a mere bro grammar and not some genius that can pull off some insane animations on the NES. So my idea was that our dude pilots the plane, then some mysterious laser or something hits the plane. The dude parachutes out and lands in the mountains. So he starts climbing up a cliff and there he finds a hut. That's it. From that point you start controlling the character. You might want to check out the hut or you might go looking for the crashed plane. Since I have a plenty of free space in my UN-ROM cartridge, I decided to dedicate a whole 8 kilobytes of character RAM for the intro. So that would be two bitmaps, one for the actors or the sprites, and the second one for the backgrounds. I created two BMP files and started sketching out the actors using the GIMP. Just a basic white outline on a black background, nothing special. After I sketched all the actors I might need, I moved to the backgrounds. I drew just the most important things that would be in a scene. Then I imported both bitmaps into the screen tool application as tile sets and did some editing there. I wanted to put all the four main colors in. Because if I drew everything just with the GIMP, some colors might be discarded or merged together. Then I exported my tilesets back to bitmaps and continued my work with the GIMP. The goal was not to make the graphics look pretty, but just to make them clear enough that it would be possible to tell what's going on. After some editing, I imported my bitmaps back to Screen Tool and using them I started putting together the backgrounds. There are plenty of NES games where cutscenes are displayed in a narrow viewport. But I decided to go full screen, because why not? So yeah, I already have a mountain background. Now, how about the cockpit, where the pilot sits? As I said, no need to make it beautiful. This will do perfectly fine. Well, I made the screen actually narrow, because I don't know anything about the airplane's interior. And I don't want to waste time learning and drawing small details. Now, onto the landing site. Nothing special there. Just the wall that the character will try to climb. And lastly, the top of the cliff, where the hut is. Okay, I have four scenes that I saved as assembly files. Now what? It was time to create a system for the cutscene playback. Well, I could hardcode everything like I did in the beginning of this game's development. That means I would describe and load everything manually. Like, let's load the mountains first, then move airplane to the right, then load the cockpit, and so on. But there was a little problem here. I was running out of space in the main bank. And by writing such a crap inefficient code, I could wipe out completely all the remaining free space. So I had to work smarter and write some sort of an engine. First things first, I decided to put the intro graphics into the bank where the game over and title screens were. So basically now this 16 kilobyte bank is completely full. I moved the data that I had in that bank to the bank 6 that was unused. So at first I created a list of pointers that points to my backgrounds and a subroutine that loads those backgrounds from the list sequentially after certain amount of time, one by one, into a name table that's located in the video memory. This way I got some sort of a slideshow that starts right after I press the start button during the title screen. And to be completely honest, I was really happy with the result. Okay, the backgrounds are there, how about the actors? I started writing a routine that transfers the sprite data to the OM during the intro scene. So how about trying to display the airplane as the first attempt? And yeah, it would just hang there during all the scenes. I found a simple way to transfer objects like this airplane to my game from screen tool. As you know, in the world of the NES, the sprites are basically 8x8 pixel tiles. And usually you need more than one of them to form your game characters or any larger, decent looking object. Let's call those large objects as meta sprites. Basically you can, like in the case of my tile set, to select the whole image while pressing the shift key. Then you can place the image on the grid by just left clicking. Or of course if it's not possible you can transfer your image to the grid tile by tile. Then while pressing the shift key you should select the image that you transferred and from the menu you should pick selection to current meta sprite. So this application can create collections of meta sprites that you can use in some sort of an engine that I assume the author of this program had created. But I don't care about that. What's important to me is the data. So we created a meta sprite. Now we can go to meta sprites and select put single to clipboard as assembly. Then we can go to our code and paste it there. We could actually write this data directly to the OM, but we need to do some fixing first. Let's move the first column to the back, and then we need to eliminate negative numbers by subtracting them from 256. Now we're ready to go. I can write these bytes to the OM one by one. In order to position the meta sprite in the screen, while you write the X and Y coordinates of single tiles, you need to add your object's X and Y coordinates to them. And that's how I got the airplane. Now of course I need to display different meta sprites during different scenes. So I created a separate file where I started putting all the intro data. The next step was to put all the meta sprites to that file and create a pointer list of meta sprites for every scene. So whenever the scene is changed, I can write different sprite data to the OM from that list. The intro looks much better now. But unfortunately, a single meta sprite in a scene wasn't enough to tell a story. I needed more. But that more ended up being just 2 meta sprites per scene. Surprisingly, that's more than enough, since the NES supports only maximum 64 basic sprites. I actually struggled to adhere to that limit while putting together this scene, because initially it had more tiles than it should. Another problem was that I could not draw the pilot and the yoke at the same level. At first I could not understand, what the heck, why the yoke is not showing up completely. Then I remembered the row had more than 8 sprites and the NES could not display anymore. So I decided to move the pilot's head to the background tile set, since the head is basically stays in one place. Also, I figured it would be too hard for me to make the laser thing working. So I replaced it with a simple rocket that would hit the airplane. Talking about the flying rockets, I needed for my meta sprites to move somehow. So during the check where I see if I need to switch to a different scene, I started incrementing the meta sprite coordinates. Since that made my meta sprites move a little bit, I gave an unique movement direction for each of them. Now things are looking even better. I also added a basic red screen after the rocket collides with the plane, so it's supposed to be an explosion. Then I needed somehow fix the yoke movement. I kinda wanted for it to move slowly down and then rise up. So I had to add a second movement direction for each meta sprite. Now the first direction is for the first half of the scene and the second direction is for the remaining time. So during a scene every meta sprite can travel in a two-point path. Still the yoke's movement wasn't that good. So I also added a custom duration and delay for each scene. Now I could prolong and slow down individual scenes. Okay, the intro movement looks good enough. Except one thing. What's up with the weird climbing animation? Oh yeah, there is no animation. So I had to implement a really simple solution here. I created another pointer list for the second meta sprite animation frame. So if the pointer value is 0, that means the object has only a single animation frame. But if the pointer actually points somewhere, that means we need to utilize this frame and switch it back and forth with the first one. So for the second climbing frame, I just simply created a flipped meta sprite of the original frame. With enough delay, it looks good enough for the NES standards. The last improvement that I made to my cutscene engine was to add some background scrolling. So like I did with the meta sprite movement, I just added a scroll direction for each scene. Also, I had to load additional background to the second namespace in the video memory. And I finally can see the mountains roll. Also, I wanted to scroll the background while the character climbs up. But I forgot that I have a vertical mirroring on. Or is it horizontal? If I would try to scroll the background vertically, I would see the same background again. So, I guess I'm only limited to the horizontal scrolling. Unless I update the background row by row manually. But that's too hard. Now, let's make the graphics less ugly and more presentable. So here you go, how do you like it now? Still, of course, there could be much to be done. And obviously it doesn't look that impressive, for instance, if you compare it to Battletoads intro. But it's still something. Plus, if I would come up with some different intro idea, I could make it more easily, just by drawing new images and tweaking the intro data file. I don't really need to rewrite my code again. For the future, I have two goals now. One would be to deal with the memory shortage in the main ROM's bank, and the second one would be to add the most important thing that my game lacks of. No, not the name, that will come after that. My game lacks of a proper ending. There is a solid beginning now. You can play the game and lose it. But for some reason, you can never win. It's not the Atari 2600 where something like that could be forgiven. I need to make that it would be possible to beat the game. So, if you're interested in my further progress and what the final goal of this game will be, then obviously subscribe the channel. If you want to test the intro screen for yourself on your console or on an emulator, you can download the ROM from my GitHub repository. I put the links in the description as always. So thanks for watching and see you next time. Bye.